Hey, everybody, welcome to What the Flick. I'm Matt Atchity. That's Alonzo Duraldi. That is Christy Lemire, back from the East Coast.
I was.
You are
also
back
the East Coast.
Also the East Coast.
But not the same city.
No. We're going to talk about a movie that takes place decidedly farther east, all the way in East Berlin. Mm-hmm. See what I did there?
I see what you did there.
Atomic Blonde, and our own Nuclear Blonde is going to tell us all about it.
The Christy? Magic of chemicals. Although I am kind of letting my roots grow out. It's a bit of a balayage thing we have going here. But yeah, Charlize is all platinum blonde all the time as Lorraine Broughton. She is a... She's a what? She's an MI6 agent?
Yeah.
She's a spy, we'll just say that. And she goes to Berlin right in November 1989, right as the Berlin Wall is about to come down, to find a list that has all kinds of agents' secret identities and details about them. The list is of course, a MacGuffin. Basically, the whole excuse for putting her out there is to kick a whole lot of ass to a pretty great soundtrack of 80s songs. Take a look. You're wrong.
I was made from the moment my feet touched the ground.
This was never part of the plan.
It was part of mine.
I've lost the target.
What do you know about this woman who's been following me?
You look like you need saving.
The one song they don't use. I gotta say, in the trailer for this movie, they do Personal Jesus.
Yes.
But that's not the song in the movie.
No, they do, we get they, on the
behind,
road.
Behind the wheel.
Behind the wheel, thank you, yes. Right.
Oh, little girl.
I keep thinking Atomic Dog.
I keep thinking of Blondie by Atomic, Atomic by Blondie. So this is basically just an excuse for her to kick ass to 80s songs. And it's a
Done.
Blast. No, it's a blast at first. It's all stuff I like. I like Charlize Theron. I like kick-ass women in action movies. I love the 80s. I love this music. The soundtrack is great. But there's a repetitiveness that occurs pretty quickly where, okay, they're gonna blast the German version of Major Tom. They're gonna blast like Susie and the Banshees, Cities and Dust. And then you know she's gonna kick ass. She's gonna beat somebody up to that song and then like walk away from it. And it's fun the first couple times. And it becomes a little wearying after a little while, I would say. It's empty.
I wasn't as wearied by it. Yeah. I like this a lot. I found it, put Charlize in the 80s and cool kind of synth pop soundtrack and let her kick everyone's ass, directed by one of the guys from John Wick.
Yeah, long time stuntman.
I'm there.
Yes.
Right? Give me another one. Ready. Already ready. Mm-hmm. Could this movie be a little bit deeper? Sure, absolutely. I think it would fit within, you know, some of the classic stuff we got in the 80s from like Carol Co. and Orion Pictures.
your
Cobras.
Right, right. Like one person comes in and kicks everyone's ass. I think that we see a good James McAvoy as like kind of the, not handler, but like, you know, runs the Berlin desk.
Right. And he's her colleague.
He's her colleague. And he's, you know, one of the things I think this movie does that's kind of interesting is, especially McAvoy's got this speech at the end where he talks about kind of the existential crisis that they're both having as the wall's coming down, right? And I would have liked to see that a little bit more deeper, right? A little bit deeper than they get into it. Because it feels a little superficial.
They flirt with the idea of, oh, the Cold War's ending, what does that mean for us? But they don't really want to talk about
right.
it.
Right. Yeah. But
that's substance. Substance is boring.
Yeah. But look, like this movie looks great. I feel like the action moves really well. It really nails that kind of almost dystopian East Berlin feel that we haven't, you know, that we've kind of forgotten about in a while. Like it's this great. I mean, it's funny, like we're all old enough to look back on 80s movies like, oh boy, they kind of nailed it.
Where were we, right? I was a freshman in college. I remember that so well, right?
And watching this, I'm thinking like, man, this looks a lot like the Kids in America video.
It does.
Right?
Also, it looks like when they play father figure, it looks like the father figure video.
Yeah.
It's like, you know, this like kind of cool apartment. It's like blue and smoky.
That's true.
You know, it's got style for days, and it's fun to watch, and it's got a kinetic verve to it and an energy, and you sense the flux both in ways that are scary.
But not the Aeon flux.
Right.
No.
The other thing I want to point out, and I'm forgetting her name, I'm sorry, I'm going to jump in and say, the other thing I like that this movie does, and I saw this back at South by Southwest, so.
I'm sure it played like gangbusters.
It did. It really played well there. And I didn't realize who it was, but one of the things I'm excited about this movie opening wide is it will show audiences how much The Mummy wasted its title.
Oh, right.
That's who she is. She's really good in this.
Yeah. She's really good in this, and it actually gives her something to do other than just be the kind of like sex object that she is in the movie.
I want this to be a series. I want a series of movies where Charlize Theron like globetrots in the 80s and, you know, kills a bunch of people and punches them in the face so that we can look back on this one and be like, yeah, they almost got it. They almost, but later, you know, in movie three, they've really nailed the tone. It's kind of like you look at Dr. No and it's like, it's perfectly fine, but really Goldfinger is where 007 becomes a thing. Because I love, I'm like you, everything this movie is laying on the menu.
Check, I'm in.
And there are individual sequences that are really great, but it kind of drags when she's not killing someone. you know, they don't get as much flavor. I mean, they get the flavor, but they don't get as much of the meat of the whole end of the Cold War, Berlin Wall coming down thing as they could have. And I'm not, it didn't have to be heavy, it didn't have to be ponderous or talky, but they could have, that could have given a weight to it. The some of the song choices are a little, they're either too on the nose, like, you know, when someone is telling somebody a secret about somebody else, they blast Voices Carry, the hush hush to the down line. You know, I do not believe that a cutting edge disco in Berlin in 1989 would be playing Reflexes, The Politics of Dancing. And I own the 12-inch, so I'm, you know, I didn't buy that.
The songs are off by a couple of years here and there.
It's one of those movies that treats like the 80s as being just like an amorphous thing that's all happening at the same
like
time.
Like 99 Left Balloons, early 80s.
Of course, in German, naturally, you know, but no Falco, I was surprised.
They did the English version of Der Kommissar.
Yeah,
that
I'm watching that and I'm thinking, really? We're getting after the fire?
Come on. Don't turn around.
But, you know, so when she's doing what she's doing, it's great. The plot, even by spy movie standards, by the last third, you're like, I don't even, okay.
Well, no, they
like,
get too cute.
I don't even think they know what the story is.
They get too cute with their little twists and,
There is a super unearned, like, switcheroo on a switcheroo on a switcheroo at the end of the movie. We're like, well,
but sure.
If you say so, fine.
You know,
explain that in the next four movies, because I don't get it now.
Do they want us to not care? Is that what it is? Just enjoy the action and not care?
I think there is a certain nihilism that was existing at the time that I think that this movie probably embraces maybe a little bit too much. Look, this movie does exactly what it says on the box, right? come on. Like, you go into this, all the marketing material, everything you expect to get out of this movie, this is exactly what you get.
But it's not as fun as John Wick. John Wick is fun even when John Wick is not killing people.
And also, John Wick has an emotional core to it, right? So, with the dog, if nothing else.
So John Wick is revelatory in that you come in like, okay, yeah, we're getting another Keanu Reeves action movie, and then you see John Wick and you're like, oh, wow, I didn't expect that. And this movie could have been that, right? This movie could have transcended what we expected. It doesn't. I don't really hold that against it, but I get where you guys are coming from. They had an opportunity here to really knock it out of the park. They have all the pieces. They got the director of John Wick, they've got enough of a budget, they've got Charlize, they've got
David Leitch.
They've got really good pieces here. And like you said, it almost works. I really hope for a sequel, because I hope that they get together for the sequel enough and like, okay, now we don't have to prove ourselves. Now we can take a breath and really dig into this.
And fine tune it.
That being said, this movie is, I had a great time. I think it was really fun. Get some friends together, have a couple of cocktails, you're gonna love it.
Or not, I saw it sober. We gotta mention too, this is really great, and you probably heard about it, this great, long, extended fight sequence in the stairwell.
I thought that was awesome.
It is awesome, and it creates a sensation that you are watching one long single take. She goes up the elevator, and she comes down floor after floor and like kicks everyone's ass. And it's a rare instance where there is no music. It's just like the pound, pound, pound that creates the rhythm. You can, if you're looking, you can kind of see where the cuts probably took place. You know, if you see like the back of a jacket swishing around, that probably is a cut somewhere. But you get the sensation that like there are long pieces of choreography that, because David Leitch was a stuntman for so long, like that matters to him. It's not overcut. You see every hit. It must have been grueling to plan and block and shoot, and so that alone, like, go see it for that kind of craft in the fighting.
There are like three or four sequences like that in the movie that make me want to recommend it to people, and at the same time, because those sequences are so good, I wish the rest of the movie were at that level, or at least, or close to it. And so again, I welcome more of this Of these kinds of movies with Charlize Theron mm-hmm. playing this character. but I think we're going to, I think if they really nail the tone and nail the sort of a consistent level of excitement, even during the talky bits, we're going to look back on this and be like, yeah, they were close. They were getting somewhere. Mm-hmm. And then by the time they got to Atomic Blonde 3, you know, back right. to Reykjavik, you know, they really got it, you know.
Where everyone's an Atomic Blonde in right. Reykjavik. Exactly.
So numbers?
My number is 6.3. Really? Is it that low? Yeah, 6.3.
It's too low.
Do you think it is?
I think it's too low.
All right.
I'm a 6.5, and I'm owning my 6.5 because great parts, but I wanted it to enjoy the whole thing more.
I'm going to stick with my 6.3 because it's like stylish and fun, but empty.
I give it an 8. All right. You guys are wrong.
All right. So what's that? I didn't do math.
That's a 6. It's a 7.
Okay,
seven.
So it is a 7. I want to mention also really fast, whoever the costume designer is, it's I love everything she's wearing. I love how then she gets off the plane, they ask her, where's your luggage? She goes, oh, I sent it ahead of time. Because she has like an entire wardrobe of everything black and white and sexy.
And a boy London shirt with the neck cut off,
cute.
Which is very nice.
Yes, and a million pairs of shoes. So anyway, it's fun and stylish. Go see it. Bye.